Hey folks, Dr. Groovy Scott Grove here of GroovyMusicLessons.com with Ask Scott Grove Anything Season 2, Episode Number 4. Okay, I'm just waking up after 20 hours of straight sleep. Yep, gotta love them prescription drugs. So anyway, yeah, I missed most of Saturday after I got home from the gig that didn't happen. You can see it, but of course I got paid. If you guys ever want to know how to get paid without doing your gigs, let me know. Nobody ever brings up the important parts. Yeah, I get paid for every gig that I don't play. I get paid for every gig. When I'm doing the DJ stuff, I definitely get paid before 2 weeks before I ever even leave my house. So there's definitely nothing like having great contracts. So if you guys ever want to learn about the real parts of music other than playing, like the contracts, let me know. Of course, today, or yesterday, or Saturday, whenever it was, it rained, so we got paid. Standard. And put it in your contract, otherwise you can get screwed out of it. You show up and get your money, and you go home. Okay, one little thing. I got... Oh, some douchebag. There's always a douchebag out there that's always after the whole race card thing. Where I'd had on my Confederate flag do-rag the other day. That there's racist right there. No, it's a Confederate flag. You may associate it however you want. You may want to call me racist all you want. But no, it's a Confederate flag. Came in a pack of six. Again, all the folks from Alabama, Lynyrd Skynyrd, everything else. Anything related to country music or southern rock music generally has a rebel flag in the back. Almost everything Harley Davidson related has a rebel flag in the back. If I wanted to be racist, which I'm not, but I could do this. Well, just yesterday there was a Saturday Night Live on, Saturday Night Live sketch. Actually, the whole show was back from 1974. Had Richard Pryor on it. Him and Chevy Chase going back and forth. Chevy was the boss. Richard Pryor was the applicant for a job coming in, and Chevy says to Richard, said, okay, now just say the first word that comes to your head after I say a line here, and then Chevy would say, tree, and he'd say dog, he'd say cat, he'd say scratch a post, or whatever, you know, and then he got to, okay, jungle bunny. Richard Pryor looking around said, crack it. And it just kept going on and on. And he kept going with more racial stuff. And he's like, you know, jungle bunny, spear chucker. And then he's like, what did he finally get to? He's like, Negro. And then Richard says, honky. He goes, something like Porsche monkey. Honky, honky. And then right there, 40 years ago is what they were celebrating. Then Chevy Chase says, nigger. Richard Pryor says, dead honky. And of course they threw the word around 10 more times throughout the episode. So this is for that douchebag out there. I would have wore the other one with the rebel flag on it, but it was quite dirty. But for you out there who just thinks that my rebel flag is so racist, here's a good song. If you guys remember Daniel Boone, you guys remember that TV show? Daniel Boone was a man, he was a big man. If you don't remember it, look it up. But here's my version. Actually, that's not my version. I heard it, and I'm just going to stick it to a three-chord thing. Daniel Boone was a man, he was a big man, but the bear was bigger, so he ran like a nigger up a tree. There you go for you racist bastard out there. So, fuck you. A rebel flag is a Confederate flag. It was an American flag. You dumb, ignorant, hillbilly motherfucker. Okay. Let's get back on to it. The thing at hand was ask me anything. Ask me how I felt about that there guy I just told you, I think. You're a dumb motherfucker and you're ignorant. And we'll just leave it at that. Okay. Okay, our first one today. They need to buy a spell check. Even better, they're... Who knows? They're okay, they're a gamer. Okay, that's why they can't spell. And he's Canadian. The name is Canadian Gamer. CDN Gamer. Sorry for giving shit at you, but hey, somebody, three people gave you... No, three people replied to you telling me to learn to spell. Okay, sorry for that. It says, have you ever been screwed really badly, B-A-D-D-L-Y, buying a used guitar? Buying a used guitar, screwed really badly, of course. And sent it back because I buy them through eBay. And then eBay and PayPal both have your back. And you get 100% of your money back plus your shipping. So I've never not got my money back. So screwed really bad, no. I mean, other than I would have loved to have kept the guitar. Kiss was on a show that is called Dancing with the Stars. And, buddy of mine, he was painting all jeans, Axe, Basis, and Punishers at the time. And on that show, Gene played, you know, the same Punisher bass for the both shows, you know, which are taped in one day, actually. But the results are done elsewhere. Gentry, yeah, Riley Gentry, painted the bass, and after the thing was over with, the sound tech, or Gene's actual bass tech, actually, I should say, I'm sorry, had Gene signed the bass and give it to this guy who collects Kiss stuff, but he's not a player of any sort. So anyway, on eBay, I ended up buying the bass. You know, it was close to 10 grand or something. And when it got here, I went to plug it in, nothing. I took the back off to see if there was a battery in it. There wasn't one, so I put a battery in it, plugged it in, nothing. So then I took the screws off, looked in the back, and there was no electronics in that son of a bitch. Everything had been ripped out. You know, there was one volume knob, and that's it. Gene, when he plays his basses on stage, he has everything ripped out anyway and puts the jack on the front and then one volume knob and none of the switches elsewhere and where the old jack was plugged in, nothing like... So what you buy is nothing like what Gene used. I mean, there's still, some of them are still the same thing, but he uses them for one song, you buy them, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, so what happened was I told the guy that all the electronics were missing out of the guitar. He was like, bullshit, you know, out of the bass. And it's like, of course, I mean, there's no electronics in it. Of course, he's asked, you know, telling me I'm a dumbass and I'm a liar and all this stuff. Since then, he's finally got over himself and he's asking me to buy my Ace Frehley Les Paul back there. And I haven't answered him, but should sell it to him, but... So anyway, finally I said, you know, since you know Gene, which he knows Gene, he's been there, he's not a dumbass, he's just not smart when it comes to guitars. He just buys the shit and then resells it. So he's just not smart enough to open up the back and look at something before he sells it. Whose fault is that? His. Okay, so he finally called up Gene's bass tech again and asked him about this whole thing, and his tech says, yeah, we always rip the guts out of the guitars. So finally he got it straight from the horse's mouth. Yeah, right after the show was over, I pulled the back, I ripped the guts out, I put it back on air and sold it to you. So I was telling the truth, so I got everything back and all my shipping, but I just didn't get to keep the bass. So that's about the worst story I have. I've had my house broken into a few times, old houses. They've went and ripped everything off in the entire house, but never stole a single guitar. How's that for wacky? They left them in the cases by the front door, but took everything else in there. Okay, so the thing was, have you really screwed up badly buying a used guitar? No. I know what I'm doing. And again, if you're doing it through eBay, you are covered via eBay or PayPal, and you will get your money back. If you don't, then you take a loaded 44 over and get it yourself. But I've never had a single mishap where I didn't get anything back via that whole thing. So the only way you're going to screw up as far as used shit goes is you're going to go to Craigslist and you're going to go to somebody's house and they're just going to have a gun there waiting on your ass and take your money. They'll always meet at a public place, restaurants, whatever. But go inside. Don't do it in the parking lot. They'll shoot you outside in the parking lot just as quick as anything. it's quick. It's easy to stab you if you just walk up to them and whatever. So you're like, damn, that's harsh. It's like, I know, but that's the way the world is, especially Craigslist. It's rough. Okay, so I hope that helps. sorry for the Canadian part. I love Canada. Hate gamers, though, but I love Canada. Here's one above there. Here. It's already starting off great. But it's from Reese 113. R-E-E-C-E 113. Starts off, sup, dog. D-A-W-G-S-U-P. Sup, dog. It's Ebonics, folks. Says, if for whatever reason you couldn't use polyweb strings anymore, this is a lot of people ask this, what would you use? Anything, because it doesn't matter. They'd all be dead within a half hour, so it makes no difference. Zero, none, nada. Any string I would use will be dead in a half hour. Don't matter if it's the maximum of 24 karat gold, whatever, they're dead in a half hour or less. Already balls, D'Addario, blah, 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 they're all the same thing. And, of course, Elixir strings are D'Addario strings. They just have the polymer on them. So, it wouldn't matter. Whatever is out there. I used to, if you want to save money, use the Darko strings from Martin. You can get them for like $1 a set. Really, just buy them by bulk and anybody can have that price. $1 a set. Darko. D-A-R-C-O. There's not that many string manufacturers. It's the same as vinyl album pressers. There's only two in the entire world that press vinyl albums. Everybody else sold their business off, you know, when vinyl wasn't selling, but now it's all coming back. Two people are making a shitload of money. Same thing with guitar strings. Of course, nobody's going to ever get out of the guitar string making business unless the string making business, period. But there are only a few people that actually make strings. And then they just put brand names on all the others. So if you think your Ernie Balls are any better than your D'Addarios or your anything else, check and see where your strings, who they're actually made by and where. And yes, most of them are exactly the same. And everybody's like, these sound so much better. And you just gotta sit back and laugh because they are the same string with a different package. So it would not matter. Again, polywebs, everything at Elixir is D'Addario. And they just have the polymer put on by Gore Industries, who puts on the polymer, which is where the poly came from. And then again, retailers said they last too long, so they were losing customers. So they asked Elixir to make strings that didn't last so long. So no, you don't find polywebs in stores anymore. Some of you have them because you want them or whatever, but the retailers have asked and to quit putting them in stores, and they only want to sell the nanowebs. That way they go dead quicker and they can sell more strings quicker. So that's why there are so many nanowebs out there and why you don't find many polywebs anywhere. So there you go. So I would use any string, and I'd probably just go back to the Darkos or whatever, anything I could get for cheap, because they're going to last. If I play them for one song and then hang it up here in my room, it's going to be, it sound like they've been on there for 50 years anyway. So if I start playing on a set of strings, I have to actually, when I put the strings on, wear latex gloves if I'm using, you know, like I used to do, so that my strings wouldn't be dead by the time I went to the show. So if I change strings, I can't use my hands. Yes, people have that acidic sweat. It has not got anything to do with your fucking diet. So anybody out there who keeps yelling, well, if you would become a vegan, and it's like, fuck you. It's just acidic sweat. At least 1 in 3 people in the world have the same sweat that I do. It has nothing to do with diet or anything else. It's just how many people actually play the fucking guitar. And out of those, how many actually even notice their strings are dead and do a single thing about it, let alone come in here and write on our little threads and talk to us on this minuscule little thing we call YouTube. Okay, so, yeah, use anything, because it won't matter after the poly stuff. Any other coatings work? None. None. They all put them on before they wrap them, so none of them work. None. Zero. None. Polywebs or Elixir are the only people who put it on correctly. The nano crap barely stays on. And the poly stuff stays on for a long, long time unless you just play like shit. There's a way you have to treat your strings, the polywebs especially, or you will fray them, blah, blah, blah. I've got a video on it. Go check them out. Things you can't do, things you have to do. You can't wipe them down because you'll tear the coating. So if you're used to wiping your strings when you're done, somebody asked me earlier, said, can I put fast fret on there? Like, fast fret is for the devil. It's just nothing but a bunch of fibers that get caught between your windings and kill your strings. Anyway, so all that shit you buy to clean your stuff. Now, if you use regular strings, just use a regular cheesecloth right here that most of you use for your strings anyway. Take it and put a little rubbing alcohol at the gig. Put it on there. Clean off your strings. They're going to squeak and squeak and squeak like you've never heard them before, but they will last longer. They'll last you a whole night if you remember to do that, but you have to let them set for your whole break and then tune up again right before you go on stage, because they will go sharp almost the whole half step because they got really cold from the rubbing alcohol. So that's how you clean your strings, kids, but not on anything with wrap on, not on the polywebs anyway. You'll kill them. So the whole damn fast fret shit, throw it away. No, I mean, it's just IBU, whatever, the alcohol, same thing, same idea, but they put it in there with a bunch of fibers that get caught in your shit and in your windings, and they go dead. So that's not a good way to do it. So this way, you don't get the fibers caught between there. Your strings don't go dead. You do actually clean out the dirt. After you wipe it on there and it sounds all squeaky, take your strings and do this too. I didn't mention it, but I've got nothing but ukuleles right here. Just grab your strings on the ones that are wound. It don't matter on the ones that are not wound, but the ones that are wound that are not coated, and take them and pull them from your guitar like this and snap them. Three or four times, and then you can walk away. That will force all the shit out of there, just like if you're flossing your teeth and it picks the stuff out of there. So, alcohol, snap your strings, get all the crap out of there, you'll be good to go. Your strings will last 10 times longer than normal, so you can make it through a gig without sounding horrible. There are way more hints and stuff out there of how to take care of your strings, bass players especially, if you will just simply go to stainless steel strings. You can play them, and as soon as they go dead, boil up some water. After it boils, take all your, you know, make sure you already have your strings off, and then tie them in a little nice little package, like you would be throwing them in the package back in there. Take them, throw them in a pan of boiling water, leave them in there for 10 to 15 minutes. Take them back out, use any rag, wipe them off, put them back on. They're going to sound like brand spanking new. Play them again until they're dead. Throw them back in the water again, boiling, after the water's already boiled, been boiling. My tongue today. Do it again. They will sound almost as live as they were the second time around. And then throw them away after that. So you can do two boils on a set of stainless steel. If you do a boil on, and same for guitar players, do that with your guitar strings if you want to, you know, really save them and make them last as long as you can. But if you use nickel strings and you boil them, you're screwing them up. You're just resting them. But only stainless steel you can do that with. Nothing with wraps or polywebs on them, though. You can't do that because just bake it right off there. Okay, let's go to the next question. Somebody names... let's see. I don't even know if this is a question. Some people. He's probably trying to answer somebody. Oh, I actually know who this is, and a good question. From Samurai Jack. S-A-M-R-I-I Jack. Scott, question. Has any of your guitars ever fallen from that rack behind you? Okay, as you guys may know, there are racks up here. There's another whole rack here. And there's another whole rack here. And there's more racks over here. So that's not just the one behind me. There are racks everywhere. See where my guitar straps are hanging? Okay, there was a guitar there, there, and there. That one right there is where guitars have fallen off of, where the straps are. Okay, that's the only place. The ones behind me will not. Some other moron asked me, I guess it's not a moron. I'm sorry if you don't know the answer, but they're saying, how come you always say don't put nitro-coated stuff up on a, you know, any kind of a guitar stand or hang them by the neck because, you know, they rip off your finish, which they do. But these are string swings, and they have a nitro-safe rubber coating on these. So this is like going into Manny's or any super high-end store. That's all they're going to use are these. These are made for those guys. These are made for 1959 Les Pauls. They will not screw things up. I got these off from a closed-down music store. You'll notice I do not have a guitar on a regular stand anywhere. This is the way to have your guitars. You don't want to stick nitro guitars in a guitar case because the color of the inside of the case, say it's a white Les Paul custom, and you stick it in a case and it has that Gibson pink thing, your guitar will turn pink from being in there. Yes, it will. Yes, it will. Yes, it will. So many wonderful videos on nitro guitars and the colors of their guitar cases. They turn the color of their case. Don't leave them in their case. Put them, hang them like this. That's why they leave those guitars hanging for 30, 40 years till somebody finally buys them. This is the way to do it. Keep them out of the UV rays. You'll see cherry colored things where they're nice and cherry on the back, but they're brown on the front. UV rays. They didn't know that till after the, you know, things change color. So they made filters to put on your fluorescent light bulbs, which were turning their guitars, only the guitars that were covered in nitro, not the poly ones, but they were turning them brown. All the red guitars, they turned them brown. But they left all the poly-covered stuff was just fine. Imagine that. So there's that. So what guitars have fallen and from where? Again, only from there, and I don't know if I can get either of these out. Maybe this one. But it was... because I have things so tucked away in here. I will just, because it's going to be a bitch to get it back in. Can I get that one down? No, I can't. There, I can. Okay, this is actually the one. It's a $10,000 guitar. And it fell twice from that location where the straps are. Twice. And did not do any damage at all. Which was one of 25 in the world. This one. The Gene Simmons Kramer Axe was where those guitar straps are hanging right there. And I heard a clunk while me and the wife were in there. And came in here. This guitar was on the ground, just right here on the ground. Not a single thing wrong with it. I re-screwed everything back in and put the insert in and all that stuff behind the drywall, hung it up again. 10 minutes later, the whole thing came down again. This was on the ground. So it's no longer up there. It's on these things. They're bolted. All the 2x4s are bolted straight into the main joists that hold the entire house together. So these can't come down under any circumstances unless the house itself comes down. So it's right in more than the studs. It's into the main joists of the house. I mean, right into the frame of the house. So these are going nowhere. You know, so anything that is setting on those kind that made by Hang 'Em High guitar stands, everything that's on those cost me under $500 now. As you can see, the only things I will stick on those. There's that $300 Mexican Strat there. There's another Mexican Strat with flip-flop green. The SEEG Paul Reed Smith things. I guess there is one American VG Strat there that I only paid $600 for, but they go for like $1,500. And then there's that Dewey Decibel upside down whatever the hell guitar. I still have to take that to a gig someday. But so now I only put those kind of guitars on those Hang 'Em High things because they fall fast and hard, but no damage whatsoever to the guitar, and fell twice in a matter of 10 minutes. Pretty groovy. So thanks for that question. I've never had any other guitar fall in here whatsoever. the most damage that gets done to them is me in here trying to show you guys guitars, and I'm going like this. Just grabbing one, trying it, and I knock it into something else. Sometimes I chip it, and if I do chip something, I sell it. If it has a chip in it, I sell it, except for my old paint guitar that's being buried with me. I'm just that way. I don't allow scratches. I don't allow chips. They get sold if that happens. So that's the way I am. Okay, Marquita Dunn asks, "Hey Scott, do you do tutorials for Black Gospel? Hey, I hope you like my intro." I'm just shitting with you. See, like Call and Respond or Praise Music. Also, how long have you been married? Okay, let's answer all that. I do tutorials on all kinds of gospel stuff. So I've actually, I guess I should do, I'll gladly do just, you know, the black stuff for you. I haven't done exactly that. I've done tons of the old hymns and stuff, but as far as the black gospel stuff, it'd be my pleasure to do them. So consider that done. And the praise music stuff, I've done a lot of videos already on these, but I'll gladly, like I said, do the race specified, so not a problem there. She also asks, how long have you been married? This is my third time being married, and as far as the actual being married part, each of them were 7 years, exactly. And like I said on another video, the first two wives both took off 7 years. 7 years on the second one too, and with me not knowing or having a single clue they were leaving, were there ever any problems in our marriage? None. Just women being women. They cheat like 10 times more than men do. And it's actually a fact. You can look it up. So I've been with Rosie now, 13 years I think, but married for 7. So, and they always either have my divorce final as marriage number one, divorce was final on my birthday, and the second one she left on my birthday. This will be our 7th year of marriage, and when it comes around for the next anniversary, this will be 7 years, but my birthday is coming up on the 20th of October, and that'll be 7 years and my birthday. So we'll see how this goes. I don't think she would do anything in the world, but I didn't think anything that the other ones would either, so keep them crossed. And no, I will not include the ukulele song and the black praise music for you, but I'll gladly do those for you. Okay, thank you much. Okay, now watch there. Marquita, I bet you had nothing but smiles on your face during the first part of this video when I was making fun of the ignorant racist person. So here's to y'all. When people are racist, they're definitely, IQs definitely go way, way down. Next, Matt Syverson, the paperback rocker, asks, do you have a chronological opinion of Mexican strats? Okay, I know what that's going to mean. Meaning, thank you. Okay. We're thinking the same thing. Are they getting better all the time? Both. They've been great since day one. After having them for all these years and getting different ones and keep trying them, I don't think there's a best time period for them. I think they are easily as good as any American put out. And all the blind tests that I've done on here through my crappy microphone, everybody has always picked the Mexican one as sounding best and the American ones, because when I do the reviews, I do Mexican Fenders against Japanese Fenders against American ones, and everybody tends to pick the Japanese ones over everything, the Mexican ones every single time. And I don't blame them for it. there's generally things that need to be set up more so. I think the American ones, they actually pay more attention to as far as the fretwork and so forth goes. But then again, if you do a setup, same with them Zager assholes, they say they do a setup out in the middle of Nebraska, but then they send it to a guy like me. What good's that setup in Nebraska going to do? None. Because you live somewhere else, so therefore the neck will be bowed all over the place and everything will be out of whack. So you can expect to do work on any guitar, but USA and Japan are really immaculate with their frets and their so forth, but the Mexican stuff just generally, to me, sounds better, period. Especially the ceramic pickups over the Alnico pickups, they just sound better. And all you guys apparently think so too, because that has always been the outcome on all the shootouts. And that's from any Mexican-made guitar from any time period, from the first factory they had that burnt down, or the second in Ensenada, or whatever. If you guys are even aware of that whole thing. If not, Google is your friend. I keep working over here because I've got a most wanted video I'm editing and it's almost done. I can't let it go or it will just, computer will shut off on itself. I'll give you my undivided attention in a moment. So yeah, Mexican guitars, if I would play, honestly, nothing but Mexican made Fender guitars. So if anybody says, hey, I want a Fender guitar, I'd say buy a Mexican one, period. Take that to all your gigs, take that everywhere. They offer way better, cooler looking finishes. You can have them set up yourself within 10 minutes, every bit as good as what you're going to get from America or Japan. So, for the money you're saving, here's the way to do it. Get a Mexican one, get it through Craigslist, and carry a gun or a knife when you go to meet the guy. Get it for $250, maybe $300 tops. And let that be your guitar for the rest of your life. Get two or three of them. And screw the other ones. They're not holding up. Gibson, as my buddy pointed out, in 2015, are raising the prices of every one of their guitars 29% straight across the board. Every guitar. Every single guitar. 29% going up, 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 up. I hope they fall flat on their faces. I really do. It's just the wrong move, man. You don't treat people like that. And there's not a 30% increase on their end, so fuck them. I'd say the exact same thing about Fender, too, if they wanted to pull that, which they may. Okay, I'm shutting off this computer now that has the most wanted gig finally converted and edited and ready to post later tonight. It's like 3:01 in the morning. So it's actually Monday morning here now. Turn off my computer and put all this stuff on there after I'm done. And again, I'm still looking for a camera, people. I know a couple of you made suggestions, but they haven't panned out. So I need something that exports them anyway to something that a Windows computer will understand, so I don't have to spend. Okay, that video there was 15 minutes long, and it took me 4 hours to convert it to something that Windows understands instead of Mac. So I need a camera that will export in a Windows-friendly format. So maybe think about that too if anybody's suggesting cameras for me to pick up, video cameras. Okay, so yeah, no time period any better, any worse. I've had the beginning ones, I've had the beginning ones. I am a hillbilly and proud to be a hillbilly, let me tell you. And I've got the new ones here. I got a couple new ones here. I got a couple old ones here. And same thing, they're amazing. And there's not a better deal on the planet. People are going for the Squire classic vibe thing. The only reason anybody stays away from any of that stuff, which is fine. They could use better pickups, but these Mexican ones have way better pickups for the same price that you can buy one for. The Mexican ones, you could buy them used for the same price as you could buy a Squire Classic Vibe for. So you might as well get the Mexican ones and not have to upgrade it. And then you have the fancy Fender decal instead of the Squire decal that people want to chip off and throw a fake Fender one on for some reason. But I've got an idea about all that too, but I've only got one person to discuss it with. Okay. Let's go up to, this guy here. Rock is Dead, 22. Who is your favorite bluegrass artist? Jerry Douglas. I know it's cliche, but Jerry Douglas on the dobro is, of course, the best. Or my favorite. You asked my favorite. But other than him, you know, you have to go to... even though it was Newgrass, that group, Newgrass Revival, man, that's what, I had Bill Monroe back home in Indiana at Bean Blossom, you know, all the time, so I grew up on this stuff big time and had to play it, and I put out Bluegrass. Here's the funny parts. I get to go up and play with, you know, Bill Monroe and all the guys back in my day and grow up and cut my teeth on all that stuff. Then I put out bluegrass videos and free ones on here, and people are writing me, "That ain't real bluegrass." Okay, let's go resurrect old Bill Monroe and tell him he didn't know what the fuck he was doing. And he shouldn't have ever taught me anything. Even though that wasn't my favorite stuff, because I was a Kiss freak then, but even though, I'll just keep going right to it, Newgrass Revival, you know, Bela Fleck and everybody else that was there, that was the one that just drew me in and said, wow, bluegrass can be cooler than what I was interested in at the age of 13 when I was learning it. Jerry Douglas, as far as a specific person. And of course, if you get him and Alison Krauss and the whole Union Station thing together, you're not going to beat whatever they throw together. So yeah, Sam over there on the mandolin and everything, always superb. Everybody should learn bluegrass. Everybody should smoke bluegrass. Everybody. okay, so there you go. I'm sure nothing different than what you expected. Okay, let's go to Harry Rhodes. And I've got a lot of emails from you I have to read, my friend, and don't think I won't be reading them, and I know they're there. And I haven't read one yet. I'm not ignoring them. I am just actually really sick and really pumped up on all these drugs the docs have me on, because I'm supposed to be, and going out doing gigs that don't happen because we got rained out and so forth. And usually in so much pain I can't walk, let alone set up or anything else, but I know everything's there, so I know where you're going to, and I appreciate everything, Harry, my friend. His question, Mr. Grove, and he's always extremely kind. You don't see this on YouTube. Harry, you're a good man. Says, how are you doing? Better, I hope. I hope you got around to checking out some of the suggestions I sent you. I have not, as you just heard. Also, I left a few questions. Or maybe better, request for you on your email and your blog on my website. And I have to get to there too. And I know that you left questions there as well. It puts it in my regular email. It says, if you could get around to answering any of them, I would appreciate it. If I re-ask them, you'd have a letter-sized comment to read, so please check them out. Thank you. Respectfully, Harry. That's a groovy guy. So if you ever see Harry Rhodes, treat him with all the respect in the world. He deserves it. And Harry, I will get back with you 100%. and the next one, I'm sorry, Harry, this is not about you. This is a clever man. Chad Hardwick. the Scott Grove is Dead guy. Yeah, the person who made that video. Okay. All you assholes out there who think I made this video to try to get some kind of attention or something. No, it's Mr. Chad Hardwick. And I know who he is for real. And it's amazing. The guy's a superb musician and a super superb artist and a superb everything. And the video is great. Him and Duncan have both been putting out some great videos. Just, you know. So I just go along with that. So I wrote back and said, okay, I'll just not respond for a couple few days and let the Scott Grove is Dead thing do what it is. And let any morons who want to fuck with you believe that shit actually unsubscribe. It's like, if that's all the more you care about it, it's like, wow, this ain't even fucking funny, man. It's like, if you don't have a funny bone in your heart, or don't respect great cinematography, or whatever you call this, it's art. Fucking great, man. The dude did a good job. And for all of you who like the Scott Grove is Dead video from Chad Hardwick, and what was the other guy's name? He's not going to say. She had a funny name that he threw in her. But I had to download that one right away with my YouTube downloader, and I put them in a video scrapbook I have of people who make videos or songs. Some folks out there made some great songs about me. Scott Grove! There's just some great crap. But here, that's who this is from. Chad Hardwick. It says, on behalf of the Channel 4 news team, I must applaud you for remaining discreet and tight-lipped about the uber-talented creator of that Scott Grove death video. See, right here. Who may, in fact, have to enter the witness protection program. Then Sticklewitz goes off his Thorazine and begins his real three-state skilling spree. The guy who was named as my killer. What a fucktard that guy is. And for real, yeah, he's retarded, but that doesn't give you a right away, if that anything. And that ain't no bullshit. Boring. Boring. I hate Scott Grovis. I hate Scott Grovis. I wrote to him 3 times, and he never replied back once. That's because Scott Grove was doing 3 gigs out of state, dumb fucker. And I got back home, and he's all over my shit. It's an actual retard, so you shouldn't call him that. They are retarded. That's a real name for people who are retarded. And abbreviation, retard. Again, yes, I have retards in my family. Fully. Should have been driving the short bus retards. Way off, way worse off than this guy is. They go out and kill people and other stuff, but this guy is just mental. Living out on his own, I guess, well enough, but again, still a total dick. So those of you who know who he is, I'm sure you know. Go check out the Scott Grove is Dead video. Look for the killer on there and you'll understand who I'm talking about. And go check out his real channel. My God. Shouldn't laugh at retarded people. Why not? They're funny too. Hey, if you can't laugh, fuck you. Okay. Thanks, Chad Hardwick. And again, no, I'll never disclose who that was. But I applaud you immensely. And he's been a good friend on YouTube forever. I'd love to meet the guy. So, okay, from Harry Rhodes again up here. I like to talk too. The difference is you have people that want to hear what you have to say. I don't. Oh well, that's life. Respectfully, Harry. Harry, I'm sure you do have people that would love to hear what you have to say. You just have to get people either who hate you so much that they just respond all the time. I get way more response. I block more people per day than I answer messages from good people. That's just, it takes so long because you have to go through Google Plus and block them there. You gotta block them everywhere else. I have to use different browsers to block people because one will allow me to do it, other ones won't. It's weird how it all works, but Harry, you're a good man. You need to put out a bunch of crap that just nobody believes with, and then everybody will be knocking on your door to hear what you have to say next, and just to knock you down. But yeah, so people like controversy more than they like the truth. That's where you get it. See, I tell the truth on everything, and that pisses people off. So if you want more views, tell the truth. That'll piss people off. But if you want a huge following, just tell them what they want to hear. Okay? So lie to them, Harry. Lie your ass off. And you'll have so many friends you won't know what to do with. Okay, here's a great buddy, a good friend, and I would love to meet this guy in person. He's got a good band. He's got a good head on his shoulders. He's a special dude, and meaning that he's a close friend, and I would love to meet this guy. John, I don't even know how to pronounce his last name. J-A-R-E-M-A. So, Jeremiah, Jeremiah was a buffalo. Okay, so John, I have to find out what happened to this Flying V, too. I know he wrote me about it, but I got to find out. Is it in here? Flying V. Told you. And great guy. There's a handful of great people that I have subscribed to my channel, or whether they're subscribed or not, but the rest of them are just people. And I'm as glad to answer your questions or do whatever for those of you, too. But there are many that come here often and are very kind, and John here, he sticks out. Scott, how the hell are you? I'm fine, my man. I'm doing what I can. Says, I'm doing good on my end. Okay. Had a few guitar-related problems in the past few months. Remember that Flying V I had built for me?
Yep.
The pots in that particular guitar had given up on me, so I found me an LTD. Oh, people on their poor LTD guitars. MH series, couldn't tell you. If I see LTD, I honestly look the other way. Anything to do with ESP, I look the other way. ESP, of course, was Kramer, for the most part, back in the day. They would build all the stuff, and sometimes they would assemble them at what was supposedly the Kramer plant. They never built anything. They would paint them and screw them together, but there was no actual building there. They just get ESP would make shit for them, and they would call them Kramer. Okay. And there were some other people that built for them, too. I'm just throwing in a jab for all the Kramer fans out there that constantly get pissed off about me for telling the truth. Especially one guy who pretends he is somebody who he's not, that was a big wig over there, and I've called the big wig himself and let him know who you are, and he is not happy. Butt fuck. So I'm going to go to the Kramer forums and expose someone who is pretending to be somebody they're not, because they live in California, the dumbass, and the real people, of course, live back in Jersey. And still have a shop going on. Okay, so let's get back to John's guitar. Okay, so he got him an LTD guitar. Sorry about that. But, which was built exceptionally well, but the damn Floyd Rose Special Bridge was built so poorly. The saddles were cracking, etc. Imagine that. Something from ESP and LTD. Okay, so I took that back. Should have asked me about that LTD shit before you bought it. I took that back and played many other amazing, and ended up taking my least favorite one home, the Les Paul Studio. It felt amazing, and I slapped a roller bridge on there, took the pick guard off, cut the nut properly, since Gibson always fucks that up. They have never properly cut a nut, ever in their lives, except for on my Corvus guitars, where they did a straight Strat-style headstock, and all the strings went straight through the nut, straight to every single tuning peg, and that's the way it's supposed to be. But other than that, they have never cut a nut correctly for any other guitar. And she plays like a dream, see? And with my Check Your Nuts, Dumb Motherfucker video, there are life-saving or guitar-saving hints there. If you don't like the word motherfucker, get over it for a little bit and learn how to work on your nuts, because it will save you guys tons of headache. And again, the old Nigel all the time, now that I'm speaking like that, will be up very shortly, so Nigel gets his own channel. So I slapped on my roller bridge, okay, and everything was like a dream. But my question to you, how can I set up a Floyd Rose bridge, floating or non-floating, when the bar can only do dive bombs but not pullbacks? I've tried many methods and I've always encountered problems. Thanks in advance. Okay, again, the only guitar that I have here is the Ibanez. And it's this is the Edge Tremolo, you know, one of their many Edge Tremolos, but I'll show you guys. Because I don't have guitars with Floyd Roses anymore. It's not because of the Floyd Rose, because I love a Floyd Rose more than any other whammy out there. If it's the original one, all the other ones can suck dog. But I can show you on the Edge here. I have to be careful doing it on this guitar because it is so pristine and barely played that I might even try to find somebody that has a guitar with a Floyd on it to show it to you. They'll never know I opened it up and did all that. But yeah, I'll show you how to do all that. It's very easy. Actually, people make the Floyds seem so much harder to work on than they are. They're probably one of the easier bridges to work on as far as whammy bridges. Very simple. They're very much to them. People have a lot of problem with it just because they're afraid of it. But I know John won't be afraid if I show it to him. He'll say, "But damn, that was easy." And he'll apply it and he'll go right in there and not even give two thoughts about it. He'll say, "If Scott told me to do this, it's fine to do." So yeah, I'll do that and you'll be ready to go. Yeah, never be afraid to work on your own guitars, people. That's why they give you a truss rod wrench. They want you to do your own truss rods. A truss rod is not a huge deal. It's a huge deal in setting up a guitar, but you're not going to bust your guitar by turning it. Chances are 1 in 1,000,000 that you'll do any damage at all. So that's why they send you the wrench to work on it with the instructions. And now, these days, there's 8 million people like myself who tell you how to do it. And everybody bitches at me saying, just because I'm me, that ain't how you do it. It's like, funny that all mine play perfect. In this weather, or these conditions in the middle of the Nevada desert, and everything plays great. Okay, so I'll do that for you. We're going to Don. Don Patton. Sorry, Don, but hey, I don't know if that's your last name or you made it up or whatever, but P-A-T-T-E-N-A-U-D-E. You gotta say it along with me. Okay. That says, "Hey buddy, I've been taking your music lessons for some time now, and I have progressed to no end." See, motherfuckers! Everybody always says, Scott Groves, especially on these Rezo Hangout. Go to the RezoHangout.com. Or any of the pedal steel places or anything like that, and where they bash me. Oh, Scott's pulling a scam, teaching people how to play like shit because he won't use a finger pick on a steel guitar. Oh, that's Scott Groves pulling a scam. So everybody do that. Go to the Rezo Hangout, like the Resonator. Rezo Hangout, or any pedal steel places. Give them guys some shit. Again, yeah, I teach everybody to play faster than anybody out there with no Mary Had a Little Lamb bullshit, unless it's by Stevie Ray. Back to you, Don. And so I was wondering if we could gig together for the next couple of years. Why not? I'll just talk to the band, or we can get our own band together. This is the only reason I will come out of retirement. Let me know when I'll line up some gigs. Glad you're still with us, my friend. See? So Chad Hartwick, he says I was dead, but this guy knows better because he's smart. Don, yeah, hell, where are you? Tell me where you're at. I'm willing to do anything if you're worth a shit and you don't embarrass me on stage and vice versa. I've embarrassed many people on stage to the point where they say, "Get the fuck out." Why? Because they're playing some weird-ass, long-haired, long-beard kind of music, and I'm a country guy, so I wasn't welcome. Because I refused to use, you know, a Marshall stack and a whammy bar all night long. But hey, honestly, just let me know where you're at. What you got in mind? You never know. Stranger shit's happened. Okay, Martin. Martin writes me quite often and is a cool dude. So, Martin H. Right here we have a question that I'm not sure how to answer, dude, but let's go with it. This involves Marty. I'll leave Marty alone. Marty does good things for good people. And I always recommend him for people who want to learn easy songs. So, Marty does a world of good for people on YouTube who want to learn how to play easy songs. It says, and he's a person who, reason I'm saying that, he's a, spokesperson or what have you for this product that you mentioned here, Martin. It says his question, so everybody can get in on it. Other than your own teaching videos, what do you think of tools like Marty? No, he's not a tool. Sorry, I had to do it. What do you think of tools like Rocksmith, which is some kind of a guitar what is that, garage band bullshit? What the hell was that stupid fucking game? Rocks. I know you guys are yelling it out, but I am not a fucking gamer. I have a life. Yeah, that thing that you guys are saying, Rock Band or whatever the hell, Guitar Hero, that's the one, both of them. But it's supposed to be more for people to actually play a real guitar along with. And Marty Schwartz, they got him as being the number one online teacher, and gave him some whatever incentive to promote their video game. What do I think of that, Steph? I don't know. I've never played it, so I can't honestly give you an answer. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, it doesn't. I think anything that sticks people in video game mode is bullshit, but that's me. If it does anybody good, then I guess it's great. But if it... It's hard to say. I honestly can't give you a real answer. It's just, I haven't played it. I've never seen it other than the commercial with Marty, you know, at the end going, "This good." You know, but I don't know what it said, but I've seen it once, just that much. And I've never played it, so I can't give you a educated anything answer of any kind on that. If it works, cool. If not, whatever. I might go on here now and look at it and then maybe do an amendment on my next video and say, hey, I went and checked it out and I just want to watch somebody play it first. But again, I haven't pre-read any of these, so I don't know what's going on. Otherwise, I could have watched a few segments of people playing it and actually learning and testimonials from people that are not paid. See what it really is. So I promise I'll go ahead and do that. Watch some people play this Rocksmith thing at their own house and no paid commercials. And I'll take care of that. And I'll answer you honestly on one of these videos still within this session. You know we got another 20 hours to go. So, and here's Martin's second question. And it's a valid question. And you already know the answer because I've done it before. It says, are you growing your hair for locks of love? Of course. I do it all the time. I grow it to the point where I can get it the right length and then still be able to get it cut off and go right back to short again and still have enough hair. But I give it to an inch or two longer than the length that they request and then I get my hair cut. I've been doing it my whole life. So I've always gone from really long right back to really short. People are like, why do you do such extremes? Locks of love. A lot of cancer in the family. It's got to be done. Not enough people do it. So, yeah, for sure. That's what it always is. I get, you know, that haircut every 2 years. Then I give the locks of love. All my lovely locks. It's not gray yet. This is real. Everything's real. Nothing is colored. Again, people who just don't know how life works. Men generally go gray in their beards 10 years prior to this. So I've got about another 3 donations of hair to make to Locks of Love. And people that are older too get gray hair from Locks of Love. So I'm sure they won't mind taking that either because my hair is as healthy as I'll get out, as you can tell. I don't know if they need beards, but we shall find out. Okay, give me 2 seconds, man. I'm going to refill my tea. Take a pee and add another half hour to this. Catch you in a sec. All right, my leg is empty and my glass is full. Starting up another little laptop over here so I can get my most wanted gig log uploaded while I'm doing this. So if I go away, that's where I'm going. I'll still stay here, but okay, let's go on up. We got Keith Gerber. G-E-R-B-E-R, like the Gerber baby. Okay, we have, Okay, I know who he's talking about here, and I will have to go look, dude. Again, I haven't read this, and I will tell you on another episode. He asks, is that your picture on the counter behind Rick's desk on, you know, Pawn Stars? That's done here in Vegas. I don't know, I'll have to go look. It could be. Been there, done that. I don't know why he would have it on behind his desk, but I'll go look and I'll watch some episodes and find out. It says, will you have an Essential Licks video series? I've got a few that I thought were very much that. But he says a very video series. There's a few questions here, which I'll go ahead and take because it's very small. It's very small. An Essential Licks video series, it would have to be done on here only and not on my website, or as far as something for sale for now, until somebody makes a 128 gig flash drive that is of decent price, because I can't make any more paid videos to put out, because nothing else, I can't fit any more on the largest flash drives that are for sale that you guys will actually pay for, you know, because I don't make any money on these things. I make what it costs, the $49.95 that it costs you to download. Then I actually pay the other money for each flash drive because they're not cheap. And so I make no more money off the flash drives than I do when you download everything, other than you get to save some time because you don't have to download it. But I can't fit any more on these. That's why I'm doing no more paid lessons at the moment. There's a bunch of them that should have been paid because they're damn good. But in order for me to do that Essential Licks series, I would like it to be paid, of course, because there are definite licks that everybody should be doing. But I've got a few of them actually here, on here, where I've actually called it pretty much that. So I'll try to look all that up and tell you which ones. I think I did like must-have licks or something on here, and they're going to be on my website too, but as freebies, as far as under my channel, or you can look must-have, or I'll get the titles of all those. But if you go to my site or right here on YouTube and just get my videos, you'll see some, and they basically are that. They're the Essential Licks that, and it'll say for guitar, one of them is licks for bar band guitarists or something like that. That's one of those also that is just, I mean, every quick lick that everybody should have, you know, that should just be there. I mean, if you don't know these, you have no business being on stage, because you can use, just from that one video, you can make a living playing just those licks over and over again and putting a little bit of different flavor on it the second time around. But keep going, and I will come back with more information on this and about the picture there on Rick's behind Rick's desk on Pawn Stars. It's also, he says, being a woodworker, have you ever made your own guitars? Yes and no. I've made them for other people, just parts. So whether they wanted a body or whether they wanted a neck or stuff, and then they finish them. But I don't do them from beginning to end for one reason. And that's going to be for the same reason out there. For you morons, sorry to do this, but for you morons that are out there buying stuff from, what's that horrible company? They make great stuff, but they charge 10 times more than they should, and you shouldn't buy from them. The place that just sells the fucking parts, and then you guys do a build a kit. Man, you guys might as well buy a fake Strat for $50 on here from Behringer or something, and take it all apart and put it back together instead of going to that company. Who the hell are they? Warmoth. Is that Warmoth? There's a few companies like that sell all the parts for you to put together a guitar. Have you ever finished a guitar? Yeah, put the paint on there. 99% of you guys that would buy something from All Parts or Warmoth or whatever, whoever makes custom bodies and necks, and you know, you put them all together as a kit, and then you can't sell them for 1/100th of the price that you paid for them. Unless you have them finish them, you can't put a finish on a guitar. Don't try to use spray cans or whatever. The only people that end up doing that stupid shit are punk people who will stick stickers all over them and put them, you know, use spray can, rattle cans and spray paint them. But to do a proper finish, nobody out there knows how to do it. Most of you guys end up trying to do a natural finish with tung oil, and then ends up with nothing but a bunch of Chapman looking stuff. Was that a dig? Yeah, might as well be. Why not? I'll call it a dig. He's going to give away a guitar right now. I told him to send it to me for a review. I'll take it, and then I'll send it right back to him for free, and then he can give it to little children who have no money to buy guitars. But nope, they're only going to give it to people they like, because Rob has been watching, and he's not going to give it to anybody that he don't like. And that guitar place up in Minnesota, they had to get their 2 cents in Riff City and say, this is only for Facebook subscribers, and you got to do like a little jingle for us and upload a video of you playing a jingle that we can use for our store and get on Facebook. Man, some people don't have Facebook. People like me don't want to even be found on Facebook, you know, because you might have 300 children out there. That's a bad fucking promotion. So fuck Riff City and fuck Rob again on that one. Bad move, kiddies. Should have just done a giveaway like Rob was starting to do before you made it all sales pitchy again. Bad move. Bad karma. So everybody go look for that brand new video where he's giving away his guitar he's been writing songs on. Bad, bad, bad. Okay, sorry. being a woodworker. Okay, yeah, so I won't do the finishes because I can't. This is definitely not the place to be doing finishes in out here. And if you can't do a proper finish, you have no business trying to paint a guitar, period. So if you are not trained in painting and finishing wood, okay, if that's not your thing, I'd build distressed furniture. So, yeah, the thing I always bitch about is the distressed guitars and stuff. So I could do it that way, but it would have to be an actual decent finish to begin with to make it look distressed. But that would be the only thing that keeps me from doing my own guitars, and I have no intention on setting up an actual room that needs to be set up for doing finishes. So I have built many, many of all the parts for guitars, but never put one together of my own stuff and tried to finish it or something. No interest in trying to learn how to finish a guitar. Okay. And I said from scratch, I would like to order a Scott O'Caster, or is it a Groovy Grove Grover Caster? I've got 4 so far here that were built for me, and all are perfect in their own way. And I would just tell everybody how I want it and watch it along the way, and if something starts to go screwy, I have them fix it, and I let the people who are pros at it have at it. That's it. So, do I ever plan on putting out my own line of guitars? No. Nobody would ever buy them. Why? Because nobody wants guitars that don't have any knobs on them. Except me. So, who in their right mind would buy them? Nobody. Everything else about them would make perfect sense. Nobody understands that part of it, but everything else on there would be roller everything. You would be able to do so many amazing things with them, but people are not into guitars that make sense. People are only into guitars that have been around for 80 years and none of the technology has changed. They just want some reproduction O'Caster that has always had its very, you know, well-known limitations, and they want to play guitars that are fucked up from day one. So they want a reissue of a 1954 Strat. Why? I don't get it. So no, I would never in my right mind even think about doing that. Putting out a Scott Grove guitar. You guys can look at what I have. If you like them, have them built by the same people. And that's as close as you'll get. You know, I don't expect to sound short, but you want the truth, I give you the truth. So these guys have always made amazing guitars, and they'll make you the same one if you like any of the guitars I've had put out. And I will have more guitars made, and they will have things on air that you can't possibly imagine. But then again, nobody other than me would probably want them for the same reasons that I just mentioned, because everybody only wants a reissue Paul, SG, Tele, or Strat. That's all anybody in the world wants. And that's because they've been brainwashed by morons here on YouTube and fucking Guitar Center their whole lives, so that's all they're going to stick to. Okay, I'm going to make a few changes on here, and I'm gonna put you on pause. Hang on. Okay, I'm back. Just uploading the most wanted video. I had to give it a name and all that kind of crap and set my preferences. Okay, so back to see where we're at. I pretty much crossed this page out. I'm still finished the last couple questions on it, and that should get us through this one. Let's see, where was I at? Since I restart, it keeps going to a different place. I wonder how long this is. I don't know. Because I've shut it off a couple times. I forgot to check and see how long this is. Oh well, if it shuts off, it shuts off. Okay, let's go on up to Delbert McLaughlin. Dear Mr. Grove, I really like how honest you are. Thank you. I look up to you as a guitarist. Man, you are giving me some good praise there. I'm glad you do. I mean, don't get me wrong, but you know, when I did all these lessons, I was definitely out of practice, and being in the band now is just barely getting me back into sounding halfway decent, but I appreciate that you enjoy what I do, so I should just take the compliment and shut up. But so it says say thanks. So I just want to say thanks. Also, Mr. Grove, I'm again, I scribbled through all this stuff, so I shouldn't have done that yet. I'm a young guitarist. I wanted to know what's your opinion on a 72 Telecaster Deluxe, because in Belize, that's where he lives, Belize, B-E-L-I-Z-E, and I can only buy one guitar. Can I get your opinion on it, please? Most definitely. It's on my want list. I don't know if this, I can't tell if you want a reissue or if you're talking about getting the real thing and, you know, shelling out many thousands of dollars. The reissues and the real ones are definitely two very different things. So I don't know which one you're actually going for. So if you want to rewrite me, that's cool, and I'll be glad to answer it. Because I don't know which one, because 72 Tele Deluxe is it's a hell of a guitar. I've had one before, and of course wish I had it back when I paid $300 for it. But I can't answer on unless I know if you want the real one from 72 or if you want the reissue. And if you want the reissue from here or from Japan or from Mexico, they've made them from everywhere. Put it this way, the original extended range pickups and all that stuff are amazing. You know, they sound like a combination between a humbucker and a single coil. It's just extended range, as they say, but they actually cover, those pickups are way huge compared to regular humbuckers, and they actually, the thing that makes them sound so cool is they cover such a wide range, extended range, of the string that they're actually picking up. So if you get a humbucker that is like a stacked single coil, but it's actually a humbucker or a double rail thing, it's only picking up, just like a single coil, this much of the string. It's only picking up that much, so it's still going to sound single coil-ish. Okay, but when you get that humbucker that's quiet, that covers, picks up that much of the string, and you've got two of them, and you've got them both on, man, you're picking up sounds that no other guitar really does. Okay, because you get, like this guitar, a few companies have done this. This is the Ibanez, but that's a triple bucker, so there's three coil, triple coil. Look how much of the string that picks up. This guitar gets more sounds than you can imagine. Imagine this with two of those in here. That would be great. I would love that if they ever made one. They never did. They made one with two half ones, you know, so like humbuckers, and they made some that could slide, kind of like the Gibson Grabber bass back in the day. But the 72 pickups like that, those wide range things, are kind of like that. They're voiced because of the physicality of them, the location of them being, taking up that much string. It's, imagine putting three pickups next to each other, three single coils, let's say. Now let's say a single coil, then a humbucker that's stacked, and then another single coil, or a humbucker that's a stacked humbucker that's tapped. it kind of sounds like that. It covers everything. So as far as the sounds of them, they sound like nothing else out there. If you go to a guitar like that and it is a reissue, I would strongly suggest checking out the pickups, depending on which country you get it from. I mean, you know, where it's made at. If you can actually split, tap anything of that with the pickups that are on it, so you can actually put something on there and make it every guitar that you can possibly think. Get as many variations out of those pickups as you can, because they are very cool and they cover such a wide range, you might as well take advantage of that. Okay, because it's such a great guitar waiting to happen. Of course, if you're going to get an actual 1972 and spend, you know, $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 on it, don't you dare screw it up. But then again, if you're going to play all your life, then screw it up and make it the best it can be, because you don't plan on selling it. So, anyway, Delbert, clarify that for me if you could. You know, like on this post, you know, part four here, episode four, put me a thing down that lets me know if you're talking about a used one or a new one or from where and, you know, what country it's built in. And I'll definitely take the time to just stop and answer it in the next Q&A, okay, in part five or six, whichever. But I'll toss it in there once I know which one you're talking about, okay? Great guitars, though, man, amazing. And 72 is the one to have if it's the real one. I don't know why people picked out the 72s over the 73s or the 74s after that, but because they're the same flipping guitar. But same reason as people picked out the 59 Les Paul instead of the 58. It's because that's what Jimmy Page had. No other reason. Otherwise, they're the same fucking guitar. Okay, Bill. Bill Bounou. B-O-O-N-O-O. He asked, top three guitars. Well, I don't know what that means. What are the top three guitars in the world? What are my top three guitars that I own? What are the top three guitars that I wish I had? It's kind of hard with a question like that. So, I don't know what to do with it, dude. Some people say sometimes less is more. Not in this case. Top three guitars. I don't know. Do they have to be the ones I own? Let's see. Of course, everybody knows the answer to this. If you're watching, my favorite guitar, period, is this. You know, the first year Pink Paisley that I played forever and ever that my first wife would not allow me to have, but since she went off and started fucking the paraplegic that, or quadriplegic that left her, gave her all his money, first thing I did is run out and buy this guitar the very next day. So that's my personal favorite, and I will be buried with that one. Okay, the actual best guitar I own, regardless of being my favorite, here's the best guitar I own. Made in Westwind Music that doesn't exist anymore in St. George, Utah, but the guy still exists. So Gary Huff. And the other great guy, other guy there, I can never remember his name. I hope he's still alive. Was it Lyle? Or close to it. Anyway, it's on my website. So that's the best guitar I own in the world, period. The other one's my favorite, just because it has been through hell and back. It was my guitar for my entire life, that Pink Paisley one, as far as my professional life. And then, number three, again, if you're asking me, it could be any of these Paul Reed Smith Korean SE-EG guitars. That's where it would go. In all honesty, yeah, the other ones I have are great that I had made for me. But if you need top three guitars, you know, I'll answer the other ways too, just to cover them. But the SE-EGs with the stop bar tail piece, not the whammies, decked. Everybody keeps saying, well, if you deck them, it'll be exactly the same as these. No, it's not. It's not. So all you people in the forums that say, oh, you might as well go ahead and just, you know, deck the tremolo, which means block it, then it's going to be the same as this. No, it isn't. It should be, but it's not. I've had the other ones, and they are not the same guitars. If you're talking about, if you want to ask me what are the top three guitars that I don't own, I don't know. Let's see. that I've actually played, that I enjoyed, that I don't have, or that I have had. I wish I had never sold my Gibson Les Paul Studio Light M3 model. So you could use all three single coils, or two humbuckers, or whatever, but it did everything. Except for that big chunk of fucking neck where it hooks to the body. Other than that, it was a great guitar. That thing did everything. I wish I could get that one back. I don't want the blue one that's on eBay right now. It's horrible. Let's see, what else has been fabulous along the years? Or that I would want. I'm looking, I would love to have a Moonstone for back in the 70s and get it, grab a an Alembic also from back in those days, Series 1 Alembic guitar. Of course, you have to drag around the power supply cable, but they just made some very phenomenal guitar. Kawai did some nice copies of them too. So those would be the ones that I don't have here. Other than that, top three guitars. Let me give you the top three companies where you can just buy anything and throw a brand name out there. I know people can make shit guitars, and every company makes shit guitars. Every company can make great guitars. The most underrated guitars that should be top are going to be G&L. They're going to be, so G&L, Music Man, and Godin or Godin. Those are going to be your top three guitars from me, who make actually the best guitars that are still being made as an overall, even their imports. And Godin or Godin out of Canada, they ghost build so many guitars for other companies, but that's been going on forever for lots of places. So I've got a ghost building video too, and they're included in there, who they have made guitars for forever that you guys own, who you think have their own company, but they don't. They just, again, they're just like everybody, you know, just like the people who make these PRS SEG guitars are the same people who make the Chapman guitars or whatever, but do they build them as well as these guitars? I don't know. I've never tried a Chapman guitar, but they only make them as well as they get paid to. They make them to the specs that you ask them to. You know, that's, you know, the World Guitar Company, Instrument Company. So they will make the shittiest guitars, and they will make the best guitars depending on what you tell them and what you pay them. You know, so I hope that helps out. Top three guitars in all kinds of different ways I could think to word it. I don't know how much time I honestly have left on this video, because like I said, I stopped this video a few times and it's got the time just running on it, and it's definitely wrong, so I don't know how long it's been going. Okay, let's... I'm just going to do one more question then, and this is because I don't want to have to say all this on the next video. So I will go up to the next one, which is going to come from Mr. Bones. And this again goes to the total dickheads at the fuck up website again, Resonation. Okay, they play resonators, meaning basically Lap Steel's Dobros. Dobro is a company. It's a resonator on there. So National would be a brand. Dobro is a brand, but they are just called resonators. So it's Rezo, R-E-S-O, nation.com. A lot of slamming on me going over there because I refuse to use the thumb picks and the guitar picks, and that I would actually go out and be teaching people, and I'm cheating them because I'm teaching them so well and so quickly, and never so much as a single bit of flack from the people who have taken lessons from me. They love everything I do. Same with the pedal steel guitar things. I don't use any finger picks. I don't have time if I'm on stage to do it, so I just play it the way I want to. Jimmy Page plays his guitar with a bow. I can play my shit finger-picking style, or I can play with a pick, just like on a guitar. But these assholes get so bent out of shape of it. So people at Resonation, fuck you all. You guys are a bunch of arrogant pricks. You guys suck. You're a little clique. It's like at school. Just immature bunch of fucking assholes over there. And this is from Mr. Bones. And I already crossed him out before I read it, but this is what I know tomorrow. It says, why do some people get all pissed because you play lap steel or dobro, however the hell you want to play? That's exactly it, because they're just fucking old children that think that they need to do it the way that it's supposed to be done, according to some guy, some dead guy from 40, 50 decades ago. That's it. Just because they think you're supposed to. For somebody to be innovative is not allowed in their circle. Again, everybody head to Rezo Nation, sign up. For anybody who still believes in the Groovy Army, go sign up at Rezo Nation. Tell them, you know, the Dr. Groovy, the Scott Groove videos, if you have actually bought any of my slide videos or the pedal steel videos, anything related to dobro or pedal steel, tell them if you guys have ever purchased one and you honestly like them, go over there, please, to Rezo Nation and just tell them to go fuck themselves and what you actually thought of the lessons. Again, they're just spreading diseases and filth just out of their nasty-ass mouths. I can say all the cuss words in the world, and doesn't make what I say as nasty as them when they're putting down something that is the truth and calling it a lie, saying I'm doing or swindling people out of their money. I've got a... I can't remember what they exactly say about it, but you'll see it. It's bad. You know, and they're saying that it's a racket and all that stuff, but everybody that has come to me again and again and again, said they cannot find another teacher that will teach them half the stuff nearly as fast as I do, and they couldn't be happier. So once again, Rezo Nation, fuck y'all. Yeah, I'm getting rich off teaching these things, but somebody has to, and I'm teaching it better than you guys or any of your people over there. I have more hits than your people that are teaching over there. I have more sales than your people over there. I'm not ripping anybody off. They are happy as all shit to learn the way I do. Some are learning with picks, some are not. They're doing it however they want. And that's what music is about, self-interpretation and expressing whatever you have through a medium, such as whatever instrument they want to do it with. So however they want to play it is fine. However I teach them to play it, I encourage them to do it their own way, and they do. So there's nothing wrong with what I do over there. So Rezo Nation and other pedal steel sites like yourself, again, fuck y'all. Okay, Dr. Groovy here, Scott Groove, Groovy Music Lessons, Season 2 here on The Bachelor. No, no. And what was today? Episode 4. So, episode 5 coming up probably tomorrow, if I can stay awake on these things. And I will go check out the thing for a few things here, that guitar video game, and then go check out the Pawn Stars and see if my photo is indeed back there. And they've shown up weirder places. And yes, I've been over there a few times. So, and I'll check out the few things that I read here that you guys want to know about. So catch you on the next one that you click on at rezonation.com. Just go over there and fuck with them just because you can. Groovy Army, rise and destroy. Okay, pretend like they're all Wyatt over there. Go have some fun with them. If you ever look for somebody just to go fuck with, that's a great place. Just sign up and destroy them and then come back over and we'll have a good time. Okay, talk to you later. Bye.